was going to talk about lots of sugary things indeed. Much of the country is talking about that actually. The latest scam, the sugar scam, or is it a scam? Let's find out, shall we? We've got with us Dr. Harsha De Silva from the SJB. Very good evening to you, Dr. Harsha.
Good evening, Faraz.
So, Sri Lanka's contemporary history is littered with many scams. We had the bond scam, and something's happening in that in court, so all very good. We've had the attempted highway scam, we've had all sorts of scams, and now we've got the sugar scam. Is it a scam, Dr. Harsha? If it is, why do you say so?
Okay, I say it is a scam, right. And I'll tell you why I say so. The government reduced the price of sugar by gazette.
That they reduce the taxes.
Yeah, no, there are two things.
Right.
That people don't talk about both.
Right.
One is, okay, let's sort of rewind.
Right.
To July 2020.
Right.
The government made a statement saying, look, they want to strengthen the domestic sugar industry.
Right.
Sugar farmers, and therefore they are going to try and discourage the import of sugar.
Right.
So the duty that was applicable at the time was 33 rupees per kilo.
Right.
They increased it to 50 rupees a kilo.
Right.
They said this is our policy.
Right.
Right. Our policy is to strengthen the local sugar producers and discourage the imports of sugar. And in a few months' time, by October, they reversed their policy. The policy, when a new government comes and says, look, we are trying to strengthen domestic industry and these are the things we are going to do.
Yeah.
Then suddenly, why did they have to completely change that policy?
Hmm.
Not bring it down to what it was at 33 rupees a kilo. They brought it down to 25 cents a kilo.
25 cents?
25 cents a kilo.
So a reduction in the taxes of 49 rupees and 75 cents.
In fact, the letter that was written by the secretary to the president,
right,
to the secretary to the Ministry of Finance, directed him to remove the entirety of duty on sugar, go down to zero.
So duty free.
Duty free. But they didn't do that for a technical reason, because food is taxed at the border on what's called a special commodity levy,
mm-hmm,
as opposed to VAT and port and airport levy and all these other taxes. It's easier for them to adjust this tax.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, they said we want to keep sugar in that bucket. So therefore, we will reduce it by 49 rupees and 75 cents instead of the entirety of 50 rupees.
Mm.
Then what happened was, that night itself, the president's media director issued a communique, which said from midnight tonight, sugar will be sold at 85 rupees a kilo.
So they set a maximum retail price.
That's correct. So why did they do that? They want to bring down the price of sugar. Well, understandable, because...
almost understandable, Harsh, because what about all the people who paid the duty?
No. That's another matter. What I'm saying is, from the point of view of the government,
yeah,
want to give people some relief,
right?
Because everything, you know, then and now is even more expensive than then.
Mm.
You know, a few months earlier, they want to give people some relief,
right?
So therefore, they said, look, we are gazetting. Actually, gazette came later, but they are issuing a directive at 85 rupees a kilo. In order to bring the price down to 85, they reduced the tax,
right,
of 50 to 25 cents.
Right.
Okay. Now, why I call it a scam is what the Secretary of the Treasury and others are saying is that, well, how can it be a scam? The government's policy was to reduce the duties, so they reduced the duties. And the price didn't actually go down because it is sticky downwards. I saw him and others saying, well, if you increase the price of cigarettes, then the price of cigarettes would immediately go up. So it is sort of rapid upwards, but it's very sticky downwards. This is something that we've learned in a, you know, university economics class long time back. Now, that is understandable. I don't find fault with him for saying that. But what is not said by the folks in government is that the maximum price was also set.
Right.
Now, we asked at the Committee on Public Finance, we questioned the chairman of the Consumer Affairs Authority. Now, why did you fix a maximum price at 85 rupees?
Yeah.
They said, look, the board, Consumer Affairs Authority board, looked at all the data.
Yeah.
They also considered the directive by the president's office. And they decided that this is the price that is fair. And then they set it at...
So it was a control price, 85 rupees.
85 rupees.
Right.
So now... at that time, there was about a stock of about 85,000 metric tons of sugar that had already been imported and stored in warehouses of various importers.
Right.
And they had paid that 50 rupees
duty paid.
Then there was another stock of 10,200 metric tons in a bonded warehouse.
Right.
And about 8,500 metric tons of that sugar belonged to one company and the rest belonged to another company. That's a small amount of about 2,000 metric tons. Now, what happened was, the Committee on Public Finance asked the Ministry of Finance to look into this matter because there was all kinds of allegations. And the chairman, Mr. Anuradha Priyadarshini Appa, said, give us a report.
Right.
And tell us whether the reduction in duty benefited the consumers or did it not.
Right.
That was the TOR to the Ministry of Finance. Right. And they came up with this report.
Right.
Right. And in that report, it says, well, the price of sugar came down by some amount, but it didn't come down by the amount expected. Then it said, the reason for that is twofold. One is, sugar is a oligopoly, meaning there are a few players who control the market, so therefore they could collude and fix a price for sugar. It says, right, let me read. The policy directive to reduce the special commodity levy on importation sugar has brought benefits to the consumers through the declined, I'm reading this as it is, average retail market price of sugar, but not at the expected range and speed due to one, oligopoly market structure, and two, ineffective implementation of maximum retail price by the Consumer Affairs Authority.
Right.
Right. Then it says that that major six sugar importers in the oligopoly market structure has possibly earned, and I'll read exactly what they said, a kind of additional profit. There's nothing called a kind of additional profit. So when we say, what do you mean by a kind of additional profit? What they're saying is, the benefit didn't pass on directly to the consumer.
Right.
Part of it did go, but a bulk of it didn't go.
And they're blaming that on the Consumer Affairs Authority?
No. So the Finance Ministry is blaming the Consumer Affairs Authority for not actually implementing that price. And they are saying we don't take any blame because all what we were told to do was to reduce the price, reduce the duty, and
that we did.
That's what we did.
Yeah.
So now coming back to what I mentioned about what was in store.
Yeah.
The sugar that was cleared from the bonded warehouse came at under 80 rupees a kilo. You see, when it came in at under 80 rupees a kilo, why wasn't it then sold at 85 rupees a kilo?
Mm-hmm.
Because the benefit was given.
Right.
Right? And a price was legally established. Now, there's another the part of the story is that the others,
yeah,
you know, the others who had actually paid 50 rupees,
yeah,
and brought in the sugar couldn't sell it at 85 rupees a kilo because it cost them way more than 85 rupees a kilo.
Yes, but ordinarily when governments, this is not the first time government has reduced prices. Ordinarily, when that happens, does the government compensate those people for, or do they refund the duty?
No, they don't. But
so how do the traders live then?
Exactly the point. Good question. So two things happen. One is those guys who were stuck with 85,000 metric tons of sugar had
duty paid
had to take a loss.
Right.
Right, but according to this report,
yeah,
that one importer, that is Pyramid Wilva Private Limited,
yeah,
brought in large quantities of sugar
after
the duty was brought down to 25 cents, and then sold it at more than 85 rupees a kilo.
Sold it wholesale.
Sold it to various people.
Right.
Now, there's a connected story, and that is to do with Satosa.
Right.
Now, as you recall, there was a big allegation that Satosa bought sugar from this importer at a price way higher than 85 rupees a kilo.
Right.
It is alleged that they bought it between sort of say between 90 odd to 127, which we don't know exactly.
Mm.
We need to find out more details about that. But if that were the case, then it's an absolute violation of what was expected of them.
Right.
So therefore, without being sort of using legal terms,
yeah,
right, what you see is a benefit was given to the importer to pass on to the consumer. But this importer passed on somewhat to the consumer and kept the bulk of it for himself.
Right. Now, that bit there,
yeah,
is it breaking any rules?
Well, I mean, so that is a legal question.
Hmm.
When you look at it, right, if
yeah,
the government is saying, it very clearly says they had to forego, right? They had to forego 15.9 billion rupees in taxes.
Right.
Right? They had to forego. And to be fair, let me read what they say. Any policy decision has an opportunity cost.
Mm.
In case of the reduction of the duty, there is an opportunity cost by the reduction of the duty rate, which is used to refer as foregone revenue,
mm-hmm,
not loss of revenue. Loss of revenue shall occur when a tax is charged and collected on a reduced tax base, that is under invoicing,
mm-hmm,
or wrong tax rate, misclassification of goods, or not charged and collected tax on a taxable good. So so this is splitting hairs here.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, the government had to forego 15.9 billion rupees, right? And that policy decision was made because the government was willing to take that loss. For and on behalf of the people.
On that note, let's come back to this very sweet story after the after we look at the headlines for tonight's primetime news.
News First, Newsline with Faraz Shaukat Ali.
And welcome back to Newsline Live. We are trying to make this a spicy story, but it's actually a very sweet story. Now then, Dr. Harsha.
Yeah.
Put me out of my misery.
Yes.
85 rupees was legally mandated. That was the price you could sell sugar at.
That's right.
Not more.
That's correct.
So how come you just said during the break, before the break, you said that this company sold the sugar at more than 85 rupees. That's so they've right. obviously broken the rules.
Yeah. So this document
right.
tells us what the landed price after paying duty
right.
was at various time periods
yeah.
From 14th of October till the 20th of February. That is the period that this report refers to.
Yeah.
Now, for instance, between 1st of November and the 15th of November, the landed price after paying the 25 cents duty was 77 rupees and 27 cents.
Right.
Now, this is the time when the gazette of maximum price of 85 rupees was set. Now, so there is a say around 10 rupees added for other expenses, because beyond the landed cost, there's got to be other
yeah.
amounts that they have to spend. But it was sold between 140 rupees and 127 rupees.
So obviously, the person who's in charge of the Consumer Affairs Authority, he needs to be charged under Section 70 of that Act, because he's causing a huge loss to the Republic.
Yeah. So this
he's
is
not doing his job.
Yeah. So this is why two things need to happen.
Yeah.
One is we have to get the Auditor General to undertake a forensic audit.
Yes.
Because we don't want to accuse people, yeah. right, without having the actual...
In recent times, the forensic audit became very popular because of the bond.
That's right. Mm. So because the forensic audit was done,
yeah.
they were able to go back and see exactly what happened.
Yeah.
Now, for instance, at what price was the sugar brought in? At what price was the sugar sold to Satosa?
Yeah.
At what price did Satosa sell the sugar to the consumer? So it is the allegation is that sugar was brought in at, according to this, for this particular time period, 77 rupees and 27 cents, and sold to Satosa at some price that was higher than 85 rupees, and then Satosa sold back to the consumer at 85.
Causing rupees. A loss anyway to the treasury.
So, causing a loss to Satosa.
Yeah, which beyond, will be paid by the treasury.
Yeah, so which is not in this 15.9 billion.
Right.
The 15.9 billion is what they say, the foregone revenue to the treasury. So, once the forensic audit is done, one can really figure out how much did the consumers benefit, because we have to be factual here, right? Like I said, sugar prices did come down in the open market from anywhere between 145 rupees to 125 rupees. That was the range when the duties were reduced. It went from between 140 to 125, it went down to 130 to 113. So there was a reduction, right? Mm. But the question is, to what extent did the traders, or trader in this case, or traders, we don't know, benefit from the reduction of the duty which they were not entitled to?
Right.
Now, if the 85 rupee tax maximum price was not gazetted, then there is no case.
Right, but it was.
But it was. So what the government is forgetting to mention is the other side of this coin, the other part of this equation. Yes, the government did forego this tax in order to pass the benefit to the consumer.
But
instead of going to the consumer, did it go to someone else? Mm-hmm. So now what the other six players are saying,
yeah,
is that, look, this is hell of a story. We made a massive loss. Whereas X company, or in this case, it's all public information. During this period,
yeah,
of October to February,
mm-hmm,
Pyramid Wilma brought in 125 125,000 metric tons. Okay, so that is 39% of all the sugar that was imported, and what they are saying, yeah, and this needs to be verified, it doesn't really matter whether it is true or not, is that after 20 years, shiploads of sugar
came to
Sri Lanka. The second company called Amro Sugars, which had an 11% market share, Palligoda Trading 9%, Global Trading 9%, RG Brothers 7%, Woodland Company 6%, Wilson Trading 4%, and all others 15%.
Right.
So it's an interesting thing because question is, did the company that brought in that 39% have sugar stored in their warehouses, having already paid the 50
rupees? So that's the point that will need to be probed.
That's the point that needs to be probed.
So, and that hopefully will be revealed if we had, a la Bond, a forensic audit.
No, it has to be done.
Do you think it will happen?
No, see, so
do you remember how long it took for us to get to the forensic with the Bond?
That is true, but then that is why it is progressing now, right? I mean, you can make all kinds of allegations, and I'm being quite honest here.
Yeah.
If you don't have the data, you are just, you know, you're saying, look, you know, on the face of it, this is what it looks.
Yeah.
On the face of it, it certainly looks as if there has been a massive sort of leakage.
So if the government position is that there is no scam, no leakage, and this is merely something that they tried, but the people didn't get benefit, there should be no reason why they wouldn't agree to have a forensic audit.
Yes, absolutely. Because if they say there's...
Who will order that?
No, I mean, next time we meet at the Committee on Public Finance, we will ask the chairman, Mr. Andhrapriya Darshani Apa, to request the Auditor General to do it.
Mm-hmm.
He's doing his job, right? In the Public Finance Committee, it is not government and opposition. It's a bunch of members of parliament who are sitting together, immaterial of what the party is,
mm-hmm,
and you are looking into investigating these matters, right? So he will have to direct the Auditor General to undertake a forensic audit. Once a forensic audit is done, then all these things will be clear, right? But you know, it doesn't take sort of a absolutely excellent investigator, right, to read this and understand,
right,
that there's been a massive leakage of funds.
Will we see a scenario where this is going to be given to outside international forensic auditors?
No, there is no need. I mean, I have full confidence in the Auditor General.
Hmm.
To undertake a forensic audit, because this is not as complicated as what we saw in the previous forensic audit, right? Mm. Because in that, what we saw. And in committees, right, when we were looking at it at the beginning, none of this data was available, right? And we requested, right, that this forensic audit be done. And once that forensic audit was done, then the data was available, the information was available. Because remember what happened there was what was bought low in the primary market was sold high in the secondary market. Now, when the parliament committees started looking at it, that information was not available to the parliament committees.
Right.
Yes, it was known that they brought low, but to make money, they had to sell high.
So that was elicited. The elicited after the forensic audit was done.
Yeah, no, that was elicited via a forensic audit. The Parliament committee made requests. Look, these need to be done. Right. Sometimes we got bashed
but,
for it.
But finally, the forensic audit was done by the direction or request of the Presidential Commission of Inquiry.
That's correct.
Harsha De Silva, thank you very much for telling us all about the sugar deal. Thank you. Very detailed explanation. Might be boring, but at least you've given us all the facts there. Thank you. And on that note, it's now time for that wonderful program, the Primetime News. So take care. Have a great evening. And as always, God bless you.